There's plenty of great content focused on mental health and personal growth on YouTube. There's no lack of it. There are all these wonderful videos from people like Matt Diavella and Ali Abdaal and Kursagat. They're just beautiful. Mwah. If you're watching me right now, you've probably seen a lot of those videos. And if you're anything like me, you've probably seen hours and hours of them. So I've got a question for you. How much from them do you actually remember? And maybe more importantly than that, how much from them has actually changed you in meaningful ways? Out of all the hundreds of recommendations that you received, how many of them did you actually put into practice in your life? Some people might hear that and think to themselves, oh, these videos have totally transformed my life. But if you're like most people, the answer is probably that you remember some things, but not that many things, and even fewer of those things have gone into your life in kind of a meaningful way. And that's kind of the dirty secret, and it's not even really that much of a secret in the world of mental health and personal growth. Most of what we learn doesn't stick. It doesn't really change us in ways that end up mattering. It's one thing to buy a book on procrastination, it's another thing to bother reading that book, and then it's another thing entirely to have that book actually change your behavior. And this brings up a really important question. Is it actually possible for people to change in meaningful ways? Maybe particularly once you're not a child anymore, or even when you're a boomer like me.
It's been 84 years.
And even more so, is it possible for us to change our internal skills, things like becoming more compassionate, or more confident, or more productive? As near as we can tell right now, everything that a person thinks, feels, or does is based on stuff that happens in the brain. For you to get better at any skill, whether it's doing your taxes, or playing the piano, or being a more empathic listener, something in your brain needs to change. Whenever we learn a new skill, new pathways are created, and as we forget old ones, old pathways fall away over time. And particularly, the brain is changed based on interaction with the world around us. This ability of the brain to change based on our experiences is called neuroplasticity. One of the people who's done a lot of work in this territory is Dr. Rick Hansen. He's the author of Buddha's Brain and Hardwiring Happiness, and he's a clinical psychologist. He's also my co-host on the Being Well podcast, and he also happens to be my dad. He's a pretty cool guy. Here's his explanation of neuroplasticity from a recent episode of Being Well, and as long as you're listening, you might as well subscribe to the podcast through the link below.
The function of the nervous system is to process information. Information flows through the nervous system while enlisting physical processes to represent it. And as those flows occur, as those experiences are happening, mental activity entails underlying neural activity. And repeated patterns of mental activity that draw upon repeated patterns of neural activity leave lasting physical traces behind. Changes that endure in neural structure or function. And those enduring changes are the basis for any lasting change for the better in a person's mind or heart.
To simplify all of this, whenever we perform an activity, whenever we do just about anything, associated regions in the brain become stronger. And there's actually increasing support for the idea that change in the brain can be actively directed based on deliberate practice, which is pretty cool. A famous piece of research in this territory was conducted on London's taxicab drivers who have to memorize these very complex layouts of streets. The drivers who were able to do that successfully experienced an increase in the amount of gray matter in regions of the brain responsible for visual spatial processing and memory. They had to do a complicated task involving remembering where things were, so that part of the brain got stronger. So this all means that we know that the brain can change, and maybe even more importantly, that we can have some degree of control over this change based on how we practice. This might sound really obvious to you, but it's actually something that people were arguing about as recently as the late 20th century. For a long time, the prevailing view was that once somebody becomes an adult, they can't change anymore. Their brain is essentially fixed in time. And this is really good news. For starters, it means that all those productivity videos that you've been watching might have actually done something. And maybe more importantly, it means that none of us are stuck with the brain that we had when we were 18 years old. Thank God for that one. Okay, so if that's all true, then why is it so hard for us to change? Why is it often so challenging for us to build good habits or get rid of problematic ones? There are a lot of reasons for this. to offer two of them kind of quickly. The first is the brain's negativity bias. This is a really, really well-researched phenomenon, which is that the brain tends to pay a lot more attention to our negative experiences than our positive ones. So this is probably based on our evolutionary heritage. In order to survive, our ancestors had to pursue sticks. In order to survive, our ancestors had to pursue carrots, like food and sex, and they had to avoid sticks, like being eaten. If somebody failed to get a carrot today, they might have a chance at one tomorrow. But if you didn't avoid the stick today, well, that's probably it for you. This means that most of the early humans that passed on their genes were ones that were, you know, pretty negative about the world around them. This means that we've inherited a brain that is really, really good at learning from our negative experiences, but not so good at learning from our positive ones. And you can really experience this intuitively. For most people, 10 things happen to them in a day. 9 of them are neutral to slightly positive, and 1 of them is a little negative. But at the end of the day, when they're falling asleep, what are they thinking about? Well, for most of us, it's the one negative one. And remember, the brain is changed by what we experience. And if we want to build a new positive habit, well, that usually connects to positive experiences. If you want to be more productive, but all you can think about is how painful it is to be productive because it means you have to do all these things you don't really want to do, well, it's going to be really hard to build that habit. The second reason that change is hard also gets back to evolution. Many of our human traits, from our long childhood to walking on two legs, get back to the conservation of energy. We have these big, very energy-expensive brains, and back in the day, acquiring energy was really challenging. It's a lot harder to hunt and gather than it is to walk to the refrigerator. So we had to find ways to be as energy-efficient as possible in other areas of our lives, and a great way to conserve energy is through habits. Habits are unbelievable tools for conserving energy because they reduce the number of choices that the brain has to make. You can just kind of function on routine. The problem is that it's like any form of inertia. Breaking that routine is very, very costly in terms of the amount of energy it takes, and the body just doesn't want to spend that energy. We are very lazy creatures fundamentally. Okay, so summing all of this up so far, the brain can change, and it changes through a process called neuroplasticity. At the same time, though, the brain doesn't really want to change. It's kind of lazy, and it's more easily changed by our negative experiences than our positive ones. So, what can we do about all of this? I'm going to start here by asking you a question that might seem kind of obvious. Do you actually want to change? And you might be thinking to yourself, well, of course I want to change. Who wouldn't want to be more productive or more effective or happier, whatever it is you're trying to do here? But here's the thing. A lot of the time, what we really want is hidden underneath all of this stuff that we say we kind of want. Or different kinds of social forces tell us that there are things that we're supposed to want, whether it's a white picket fence, or it's making a lot of money, or it's being really effective, or it's marrying a certain kind of person. And it's really natural for us to absorb other people's wants and start to kind of take them on as our own. But changing is really, really hard, particularly changing in deep, lasting ways. And it's going to be really, really, really hard to change if we don't actually care about the thing that we're aiming toward. And I think that that just stops so many people right at the starting line. If there's a thing that you've been trying to change for a long time that's been really resistant to change, it's important to ask yourself if you actually want to change that thing, or if you're just trying to do it because people are telling you to. If you really want to make the change happen, get really specific with it. What would your life look like if you made this change? What are you going to do practically to get closer to it? What would it feel like in your body if this change happened? Would you be proud of yourself? Would you be more excited to be here? There's a huge difference between wanting something in a kind of abstract way and really committing to it in the here and now. The second suggestion is committing to incremental change. The brain changes really, really slowly most of the time. And I get it. It's not sexy. It's not like 3 tips to change your brain today that's going to transform your life forever. But trust me, that's how the process actually works. It is slow. It is boring, it is annoying, you have the days you want to quit, but that's the change that actually lasts. Third, and this is my favorite one, we can help change our behavior by changing how we view ourselves. Starting in childhood, all the way up through now, we form beliefs about ourselves. Some of these beliefs are really useful, and some of them are a bit less useful. Some of them we choose ourselves, and some of them are kind of given to us by other people. A lot of people think about this concept in terms of limiting beliefs. Those are the ideas that you might have about yourself that get in the way of you being who you want to be. These beliefs are heavily based on our formative experiences. When we're young, the brain is really extra plastic. It's very changeable. So that's part of why childhood has such a long shadow over the rest of our lives. Over time, those experiences teach us that we are a certain kind of person. And when we get new information or we try to build a new habit that contradicts that internal belief, it's very, very hard for us to take the new information on. So you might take a moment here and think to yourself what some of your self-concepts are. What are your I'm the kind of person who fill in the blank? It's very, very hard for us to behave in a way that is not consistent with those forms of self-concept. And many of those forms of self-concept were not actively chosen by us. They were, in effect, given to us by somebody else. One of the things that's really helped me personally is thinking about where my self-concept comes from and asking myself, is this something that I chose, or is it a remnant, a kind of shadow from my formative experiences 20 or even 30 years ago? And doing this has really helped me move into the sense of agency, into the feeling that I can actively create the person that I want to be. Sometimes it's easy for me, and maybe it's easy for you as well, to feel like I'm kind of just experiencing myself, like I'm in the passenger seat and somebody else is driving the bus. But when we go through this process, we don't just experience ourselves, we actually create ourselves, and at least I think that that's pretty cool. So, I hope that you enjoyed today's video. If you did, I'd really appreciate it if you would take the time to subscribe to the channel below, and maybe even, what's the phrase that I'm looking for here? Smash that like button. Quick reminder about the Being Well podcast, which I host with Rick Hansen. If you like these videos, you'll definitely like the podcast, and you can subscribe to it down below. Until next time, thanks for watching.